Is the kingdom yours? Is the power yours? Is the glory forever? Amen. Yours is the kingdom yours? Is the power yours? Is the glory forever? Amen. Yours is the kingdom yours? Is the power yours? Is the glory?
justice of our God was met. When the sun came down and paid our debt, in his hope for us, he then became our ransom.
Thank you, Jesus.
The only thing that I deserve, what I've done and what I earned, to be swallowed up in death and left abandoned.
Come on.
But the justice of our God was met.
And our God reigns.
Yeah.
Today, someone shout to the Lord. Come on, somebody shout to Jesus today. We praise your name. Jesus, we love that we get to come before you, the Holy One. Who's grateful for Jesus today? If someone loves Jesus here, let's just tell him. Let's just tell him, Jesus, we love you. We love you. It's all about you. It's our joy to come before you. You are so good. Amen? Amen. Feel free to find your seats.
Amen. Thank you. Hello, check.
Good morning. Welcome, everyone. How's everyone doing today?
Good morning, and welcome to YWAM Encounter Together. Let's give it up again for Bryce Anderson and the worship team. All right. Well, my name is Eunice.
And my name's Jason.
And we just want to say welcome again to YWAM Encounter Together. We are so excited for all of you guys to be here. We are so expectant for what God wants to do today. We have an incredible schedule, a lineup of all these incredible speakers and worship leaders. And so we just want to say thank you for coming. And we are so excited that you are here. We have one announcement, or actually we have a couple announcements. So how many of you guys enjoyed worshiping this morning with Bryce Anderson and the YWAM team? So Bryce Anderson, he's actually releasing an album, and he is so gracious. He's so gracious, and he wanted to give you guys two free songs from his album. So you can go on his website, andbryce.com, and download two of his songs for free, but it's only available for the next 3 days. So whenever you guys get a chance over the next 3 days, go ahead and go on his website, and you get two of his songs for free. Our next announcement is we have a packed schedule today, and so during our lunch break, there's actually a lot of restaurants available around this area in downtown where you guys can walk to take your lunch break. So if you guys want that information, please go to the info booth out in the front, and you can get all the information for all the restaurants that are walking distance from this place.
And today's going to be such a packed day. As we said, you guys are fully expectant. We have Todd White in the house on the deck coming up soon. Laura Hackett Park, who's going to be with us. Jay Thomas and many, many others. But that said, would you do me a favor? Could everyone pull out your cell phone real quick? Because I know you have one. Put that thing in the air. I know it feels like we're in youth group, but just work with me today. Grab that phone, and I want you to do me a favor. Today, because the Wi-Fi isn't as strong as we would like, I want to give you the heads-up announcement so you could stay in the loop on everything we're doing here at Encounter Together. Go to your app store, and I want you to download YWAM Together 2016. Everyone say, YWAM Together. There we go, 2016. Be sure to go there today at lunch, the rest of the afternoon. Download YWAM Together 2016 on your app. You'll be able to get all the announcements to stay in the loop, even to have live streaming of our event the rest of this week. You do not want to miss that. But all that said, we have a lot to do for the rest of the day. I want to get to our first speaker. We have in the house today a true legend of YWAM. He actually is one of the main conceptual architects of 4K mapping, if you're familiar. He's actually the mastermind also behind the SourceView Bible, which you're going to hear more about that. We're believing it's going to be a game changer. changer for Bibles and free technology on the internet, and many, many other things. He's been in YWAM for 38 years, has a wealth of experience, a wealth of knowledge. Truly, he's the author of Why Not Women with Lauren Cunningham. He's an incredible leader in our mission in YWAM. So could you guys do me a favor? Would you put your hands together for David Hamilton today as he takes the stage?
Good morning. Are you excited about what God is going to do today? He is present. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. He's King. We have so much to share with you today. First thing up, I want to just introduce you to a little bit of our YWAM story. The reason we're doing this is because we have been built around the word of the Lord. And these words, though they define the inheritance of our tribe, are words that belong to all the people of God. And everyone who loves Jesus, everyone who comes to his word, can benefit from hearing these words. It's not for YWAM alone, it's for all of us. Really, how did YWAM get to be this large missions organization? Over 5.5 million people have come through Youth with a Mission over the last 56 years. It's a very, very, very simple formula. One, we listen to God. Two, we obey. And three, we don't give up. You can do that. Can you say that with me? Listen to God. Obey God. Don't give up. And wherever you are, whomever you are, that will lead you to be an agent of transformation in our world today. Lauren Cunningham, the founder of Youth with a Mission, was a couple days away from turning 21 years old, and he was in the Bahamas. He was not known as a global mission leader at the time. He was the leader of a pop band. And they were performing in Bahamas, and he was praying and wanted to have a word to encourage the young people who'd be listening to his concert. And this is what has happened. Watch this video.
What I saw in 1956, June, on a Wednesday, I was at a missionary's home there in the Caribbean, and I was praying about a group I was to preach to tonight of young people. And that's when I saw this whole vision, because I'm wide awake, I'm kneeling by the bed, and I'm seeing this whole vision of waves. And it was topographical and it's global. And I see seeing these waves coming into continents. And so that I saw, and then it turned into young people from everywhere going everywhere. And I'm seeing all this picture, and it was massive, it was millions. And then I didn't know, because I didn't think about why. I thought God's going to do something. And I want to catch this.
This vision of the waves from June 1956 was to form what we know as the first of our four legacy words that define God's calling and our inheritance as a tribe within the body of Christ. It'd be four more years before Youth with a Mission would begin after this word. But there are a couple things over the years as we've reflected on it that are important for all of us to understand. At that time, God spoke of young people as waves. God has always seen young people as key in his kingdom. Are you young? Let's hear a cheer for that. Are you young at heart? Let's hear a cheer for that. God saw Samuel. God saw David. God saw Timothy. God saw Titus. And he's seen young men and women. He saw an Esther. He saw a Ruth. And he said, I can work in them and I can work through them. In 1956, that was a new idea. Missions of the day did not employ young people. You had to be much more mature before you were sent out. This was radical then, and it can still be radical today. Do you want to get radical with God? That's what this vision is all about. This vision is also about innovation, doing new things that God puts in your heart. It's about hearing from God and going to all and every. Notice in the vision, young people came from every nation and went to all the nations. Every continent, every land, every people, every language was impacted. What is the passion in your heart? What is God telling you to do? He wants you to know that there's a place for you in His plan for reaching the every. And He is not satisfied until all have heard, until all have been given an opportunity. That's what this legacy word is about. Isn't that good? About 25 years later, Youth with a Mission was now a young, flourishing organization, and leaders were called together from around the world to meet in Kona, Hawaii, to seek God's face. And when they did that, they began with a time of worship and praise, and they did not have an agenda set up, going to point one, point two. After the worship time, they said, let's each seek time alone and seek God's face. What does He want to say to us? Let Him establish the agenda. And as they went to pray, God spoke to Lauren these words that we've come to know as the Christian Magna Carta, and our second legacy word. Take a look at this.
In 1981, Lauren Cunningham was guided to articulate a document called the Christian Magna Carta, which lists the rights bestowed to mankind by God.
And God just gave a download in which I wrote as fast as I could on what I understood to be the Christian Magna Carta, which goes beyond the normal human rights.
Number one, everyone has the right to hear and understand the gospel of Jesus Christ. Number two, to have a Bible available in his or her own language. Number three, to have Christian fellowship available nearby, to be able to meet for fellowship regularly each week and to have a biblical teaching and worship with others in the body of Christ. Number four, to have a Christian education available for their children. Number five, to have the basic necessities of life, food, water, clothing, shelter, and health care. And number six, to lead a productive life of fulfillment spiritually, mentally, socially, emotionally, and physically.
If we have the obligation to preach the gospel, what can they expect from us as Christians? So our understanding of the Great Commission is much more than just a quick proclamation of the gospel. But there's so much more, and that allows us to equip tens and even hundreds of thousands of young people with all kinds of vocational capacities to go and live their lives to be an agent for transformation of the world.
The Christian Magna Carta really emerges from a deep reflection on Mark 16. Jesus, his final command on earth, says, go and preach the gospel to every creature. If that is our responsibility, that which God has given to us, the question is, the implication is, what should those who do not yet know Jesus, what should they be able to expect from us? If we're to communicate good news to them, what should they consider that Christians should be doing for them? And these 6 points detail our responsibilities to proclaim the gospel, to get the Bible to them, to make sure that their fellowships and educational opportunities, to take care of physical and emotional and spiritual needs of every kind. These are the things that God calls us as His people to do. He is not a small God with narrow agendas. He is a big God, and He wants to touch the world in the most complete, integrated, comprehensive way possible. He is God. Let's worship Him. He's a great God. Let's do great things for Him. Let's do great things with Him. Now, this passion to do great things with God and for God comes in another expression. Our third legacy word actually occurred a few years earlier in 1975. Lauren and Darlene and Karen and David were in the Colorado Rockies, and then this is what happened. And as you listen to this, you'll notice that this is an expansion, really, of Matthew 28, the other great commission passage that is often quoted. Go and disciple all nations. How could we possibly do that? Let's see.
It was in the mountains of Colorado. My family and I had taken a week off in a borrowed cabin. I just was before the Lord in prayer, and he gave me these seven ways to influence a society and help to prepare the society for transformation. I was pondering them when the forest ranger came up and said, "You have a call back down at the station." This was 1975. And so it was an invitation by Bill and Vonette Bright to come over. They found we were in the same state at the same time. We flew over and met with them. And as I came in, I had my paper here, yellow pad paper, and I was pulling it out, and he was quicker with his. He said, "Look what God's shown me, Lauren." And he had the same spheres.
Lauren Cunningham was led to articulate a concept known as the seven spheres of influence. These societal spheres recognize and define what shapes our choices, culture, values, and future.
You want to teach the nation, shape the nation. You've got to use all of these vehicles, not just the religious vehicle. That changes Sunday, but you want to change Monday through Saturday. You've got to use these other things as well.
As we look at Jesus' words in Mark 16 and Matthew 28, we see very clearly that God's heart is to see every individual redeemed, and his desire is to see every society transformed with the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have a call upon our lives, we and all followers of Jesus together, to make sure that every individual and every corporate expression of humanity, community, tribe, city, nation, has an opportunity to experience the transforming work of God. You see, Jesus doesn't want to just be Lord of Sunday. He wants to be Lord of Monday through Saturday as well. Jesus is Lord of all, or he's Lord not at all. We can't pick and choose to have him king some days and do our own thing the other days. He wants to reign all the time in every sphere of society, in every one of our personal and societal relationships. How does this happen? How do we disciple nations? Jesus gives a clue in Matthew 28. He says, by baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. You don't put a whole nation in a very big bathtub. What you do is you immerse them, you soak them, you have them marinate in the understanding of who God is, until like a pickle, a cucumber that is put in pickling sauce, it sits there for a while and is transformed from the inside out, and it turns into a crunchy dill pickle. You go, that is changed forever. God wants to change individuals and nations by an encounter with his remarkable, amazing, just, loving, merciful character. That means we got to get to know God more. That means we need to go back to the Word, the place where he's revealed himself to men and women throughout the generations. And this leads us to our fourth and final legacy word: end Bible poverty now. Would you say that with me? End Bible poverty now. What's Bible poverty? Poverty is when you don't have enough of something. We usually think of finances, and there are people who do not have enough of the Word of God. Some because it's never been translated, some live in places where they've been translated, but they've not had access to it, it's not been given to them. Perhaps they can't read, and they need to hear it in some other way, through some oral or video means. We need to translate, publish, distribute, and help motivate people to engage. We're going to be talking a lot about that this day and throughout these next few days, that God wants everyone to hear the remarkable story of his love for them. That's why we need to end Bible poverty now. Can I hear a yes or an amen? God is at work in this time, and we are the first generation in all of human history that can contemplate that it is within our grasp in not too many years from now to see everyone on earth be able to have access for the Word of God in his or her own mother tongue. This word came to us for the first time when Lauren was traveling to Mexico in the mid-60s with a bunch of YWAMers. A bus broke down in a small town on the way to Central America, and they went out and began preaching in the village plaza and going door to door. After they fixed the bus and were ready to head out, a woman in a faded red dress came up to Lauren and said, "Señor, ¿me puedes dar una Biblia?" "Sir, could you please give me a Bible?" And Lauren gave her a Bible, but as he drove her away, God began speaking to him. It was not just this one woman in the faded red dress, but millions and millions and millions who are hungry and needing God's word. Friends, it's not just the ones way out there. It's right in here. Are you hungry for God's word? Do you want to be hungrier for God's word? Who's hungry but wants to be hungrier? Can I see your hands? Can I pray for you? Lord, I pray this day as we talk so much about engaging with the Word of God in order that we might know you, the God of the Word. I pray that you'd create more and more hunger, thirst, longing, passion in each of our hearts to know you, to love you, to listen to you, to do what you ask us to do. Create hunger in us this day, we pray. And all God's people who want that sad, amen. Now, friends, because you are hungry and want to be even hungrier, we have a gift for you. This is good news. If you want to pull out your phone or your tablet, doesn't matter if it's Apple or Android, you can go online and right now, go to your App Store or your Google Play and say, "I look up the word Source View." Over thousands of YWAMers have prayed for this over the last many years. Thousands have given towards this in offerings. Over 200 people from 50 countries have researched 40,000 hours to add 16 million plus metadata points so that you have the most exciting, innovative Bible app now available this week, and you're the first ones publicly to be given the opportunity to download all of this for free. Sound good? Open up your phone, start downloading that as you can, and watch this video, and let's get hungry for God.
Over the centuries, the Bible has been available in many different formats, from parchment scrolls to hand-painted manuscripts to the revolution created by the Gutenberg printing press, all the way to the birth of the internet, where more people have access to the Bible than ever before. But it doesn't stop there. For the first time in history, we have the ability to access and engage Scripture like never before. Until now, the only way to search the Bible was to tag words with a book, chapter, or verse. Today, that all changes with a data-rich, multi-layered digital Bible tool. Introducing the Source View Bible app. This app will take your interactive Bible reading to a level beyond any of its forerunners. Imagine this. Reveal who spoke this word and to whom they were speaking. When did they live? And what was their profession? Did you know that Paul spoke to 30 different people in the Bible? With the longest conversation being with Claudius Lysias. This will give today's generation the capacity to experience the Bible in a whole new way. The Source View Bible app gives you a simple but thorough process for breaking down Scripture into characters and conversations. You will instantly be able to see the most used words and themes of each book designed in colorful infographics. Through these conversations, you will discover when they're talking about government, economics, religion, family, education, celebration, and communication. You might not have realized that 26% of the Bible has to do with the family from 438 sources. These spheres of society will let you see God's design for all areas of your life. The Source View Bible app also includes the entire Bible in a color-coded format, giving you and three other people the ability to read the Bible together as a dramatic narrative, bringing the text and its characters to life. Black text represents the narrator. Red text is used for the words of God, and blue text is used for the supporting cast. While green text is the lead character in each book, at any point when reading, simply slide the screen over to see who is speaking. Not only that, but the app will tell you how long it will take to read each book of the Bible. Did you know that most books in the New Testament can be read in less than 20 minutes each? The Source View Bible app is an innovative digital tool that was created to provide you with a fresh, enriched experience with God. We invite you to download it today in the Apple and Android store. With a few simple swipes, you might just be the first person to uncover original Bible queries. The Source View Bible app, a new way to discover God's Word.
It's our prayer that you'll use this gift and it'll lead you into a place of ever greater intimacy with our wonderful God, the Word who became flesh. And now, in these days, with technology, He becomes fresh as He dwells among us. We can see Him in new and creative ways because He wants to work today in this generation. Let me review with you. Four legacy words that apply to each of us. God calls young people to go from everywhere to everywhere because He's an innovative God and He has a passion for all and every. Two, God wants to see all areas of human need impacted with the gospel. Proclamation, Bibles, churches, schools, mercy ministries, and every social, spiritual, emotional, relational need met. Third, God wants to touch the spheres of society, families, economics, government, church, education, media celebration, media communication and celebration, arts, entertainment, sports. And fourth, God is at work today like never before to end Bible poverty in this generation. Do you want to be a part? Do you want to be a part? That is what this day is about. Tell God right now, I want to be a part. I want to be a part. Thank you, Lord, that you're leading us to follow you, to know you, and to see by your power the world transformed. Amen. You're going to see a video now, a very powerful, moving expression of how the kingdom of God is being demonstrated through acts of mercy in Papua New Guinea. When this video ends, my good friends, Ken and Robin Mulligan from Townsville, Australia, who lead this ministry, will come on stage and share with you. God bless you. Thank you.
My name is Victor. I come from Papua New Guinea. I love my country. It is so beautiful and so diverse. We are known as the land of the unexpected, the least explored country on earth. We are made up of many different tribes, each with their own traditions. Me and my people live in villages. We live in high mountains, jungles, rivers, and the coast. Though we have much beauty, we are facing very big healthcare challenges. Many of our women die in childbirth. We are one of the highest rates in the world. TB has been declared as a national emergency. Our children are dying of preventable and treatable diseases. Many of us will never see a dentist in our lifetime. Hundreds of thousands of people have low vision or no vision at all.
Makasi had been blind for 10 years. Her and her family heard about the ship being in their area and paddled in their canoe for 2 weeks to see if there was anything that we could do for her eyesight. After a 45-minute operation, her sight was restored to perfect vision. She saw her 3 children for the very first time that day. She went from someone that was downcast, that had no hope in her face, to someone that had light in her eyes, someone that had hope and excitement for her future.
It's so amazing what happens when the ship first comes into a village. All the men, the women, the children, they all gather along the shores and they start singing, start dancing. The ship is more than bringing healthcare. It's really bringing life and really giving them hope for the future.
On board the ship, we have a day surgery unit, a laboratory, dental clinic, and lecture theatres, which allows us to bring really specialised care right there to the people in the community and the villages. A helicopter will be on board, which will allow us to do emergency transfers, as well as to even reach further inland to some of those places that need specialist care.
It is a partnership in the true sense, in that it is helping to assist and support and promote what is already contained in our national health plan and working very much in collaboration with the existing health system.
The training element of the medical ship is very, very important. What that does, especially our health workers working in remote settings and those difficult settings, it empowers them, it strengthens them. It gives them that someone does care.
I've been involved now for over 30 years, and to be on this journey for so long and seeing so much change, and now we are positioned to be able to help so many people. The greatest resource in Papua New Guinea is its people. And as we have the privilege of working alongside Papua New Guineans, we can see incredible things happening.
My dream, I want to be a nurse. I want to help my people in this district and country.
One of the things I love most about the work of the ship is seeing young Papua New Guineans engaged. Seeing young, passionate Papua New Guineans from urban centres able to come out into a rural context, building their nation.
When I think of the message I want to live, it's like me like him life. I want life, and for you and for me is to have life and live it to the fullest.
We look despair in the eye and we say, you do not have the final word. We're people who have our fingerprints on a torch of hope. That's Papua New Guinean fingerprints, Australian fingerprints, fingerprints from all around the world that press forward because we want to live.
So arise, all the sons of this land. Let us sing of our joys to be free. Papua New Guinea.
It's good to be alive. Don't you think it is good to be alive? Yeah, let's say it. It's good to be alive. It's so good to be with you this morning. My name's Robin Mulligan and I'm from Townsville. I think the last time you saw me, I had an Akubra and a Dreiser bone on the stage. In Townsville, how many of you were in Townsville last year? Yeah, well, two, great. You know, Papua New Guinea, I've sailed up many rivers of Papua New Guinea. I have felt the mud of the land between my toes. And God has not forgotten the cry of the people of that land. God has not forgotten the cry of the people across the globe, the least, the last, the lost, the every. And it's such a privilege to go to these remote places and tell them that God has not forgotten the cry of your prayers. God has not forgotten the cry of the Speaker of PNG Parliament, as you read on the screen earlier, and I heard your applause from backstage. What a statement. For us to have life, we need to give life. John 10:10. For the enemy comes to rob, steal, kill, and destroy, but what? What does he come to bring? But Jesus comes to bring life. PNG is one of the most evangelized nations on earth, but yet they're one of the poorest, with some of the hardest places to get to on planet Earth. We have before us a nation with a standing invitation to come. Come and help disciple our nation. I'd like to introduce you to a young lady named Amanda Ravenhill. Amanda's with us in YWAM Medical Ships. She's a young, on fire 20-year-old who said yes.
Thanks, Robin. Well, wow. I love what I do. I mean, I often have times where I really feel like I just need to pinch myself because I get to be a part of helping a nation. Just think about that for a second. It is a crazy thought. See, I've walked the halls of Parliament. I've sat with governors and ministers in their offices. And you may be thinking, why me? Why a 20-year-old among national leaders? But see, like you, I want my voice and I want my life to count. And I didn't want to waste time. And so I knew from a really young age that God had so much more for me. And see, now at this point, I've heard firsthand the invitation from Papua New Guinea to help disciple their nation in kingdom values in all sectors of society. I mean, what do you do with that? What do you do? See, I got that invitation a couple of years ago, but today that invitation extends to all of you. And if I haven't convinced you, I want to show you a quick video of what it looks like to be on one of our outreaches on the MV YWAM PNG, which is just one of our 24 ships in YWAM. So if I haven't convinced you, take a look.
My name is John Kama. I'm from Gulf. I am the second year student of Papua CSW Training School. I had to take it and I came in and they killed my son. I was not like open up to people like talking or smiling and like put my mouth like this and end like this and smile. But now I'm very happy that I can smile.
Yeah,
we've just seen a boatload of eye surgery patients come back from Orocolo Bay, about 90 kilometers away. They'll be having surgery today and tomorrow, and then we'll take them back to their village.
Membro minomen baya. Program is the eye. Yesterday I come here. Before I see the like this, the snow. Yesterday operation, now I can take out the crust and I see the everything. Now I'm very happy. See, my God is there, the heaven. And I see the very night now. Thank you very much.
My name is April, and I'm a research scientist with the University of the Nations, and I'm currently sitting in a brand new lab on the YWAM PNG. Having a mobile lab on a ship has the capability of bringing diagnostic tools to places that do not have either a microscope or the ability to stain for tuberculosis, leprosy, or other things that we will look for. We screened 40 slides, which corresponded to 9 patients. One patient was diagnosed with leprosy and 2 with pulmonary tuberculosis.
Good morning. It's such a privilege for us to be here this morning to represent just a part of YWAM and the incredible ministries that go on around the world. So my name is Ken Mulligan. I'm the CEO of YWAM Medical Ships Australia. A little bit about me, my background, even though I'm involved in ships, I come from a farming background. I get seasick, which is really interesting. And I don't actually like ships too much. But I love what they can do. This week is going to be a very special week. And I believe that many lives will be changed. Don't we want that? You know, you think about this. I don't want to just come for a gathering, or it's great to meet people and spend time. But this is a very special week. And there's much in front of us. And there's much to do. So I wanted to tell you a story of a young man. A young man that's in Papua New Guinea who lives in a very, very isolated part of the world, who doesn't have the services that many of us have. It's hard to believe that this young man, being 17 years of age, was completely blind. And when you are completely blind in a village, it limits your choices greatly. And why am I telling you about this young man? It's not just about the numbers. We want to believe God for the tens and tens of thousands of people that need to hear the good news and to be able to have some hope. But Bray, being a 17-year-old, we were wondering and weighing up whether we could actually help him, because it's not just a conclusion that he would get his sight back. So cataracts are not a pleasant thing. Not many of us realize that even a 17-year-old can have them. But as we looked, and our specialist, Bill Talbot, on board our ship, he evaluated what we could do and whether we could even operate. Can you imagine what it would be like? Some of you even know this, in anticipation of, I wonder what the results could be, to be able to see again. So we took him into the surgery, and he was operated on. And the anticipation for him, waiting to see whether he could see the next day, as the nurse was able to pull off the patch and to be able to see. You know, it's one of the most dramatic operations that we do on board. It's a simple operation, lasting about 40 minutes. And this young man, the nurse puts out a hand and says, give me a high five. And he hits the hand with a high five. And the joy that comes into his heart. But his brother had been helping him for the last number of years, because what had happened, as he became totally blind, their family heard a little bit about this YWAM ship that may come into the region. So they prayed for 3 years. And when the opportunity came, they said, could you help? And we had actually left their area, but we thought, this is such a God thing. We need to help this young man. So this is the surgeon in Bray saying, thank you. And I was actually on board the ship at this particular time, being able to just congratulate this young man. This morning, as we consider and as we think about the good news that we have, it's good news, isn't it? When is it good news? You know, the gospel, if it's not good news to the poor, it's not good news. You think about it. There's so many people that live in isolated, lonely situations without hope. And we have the privilege to go. We have the responsibility to go and to engage. So as I think about this time, this wonderful opportunity, let's make sure that we press into all that God has for us. Let's believe God for a season of change for many people. You know, with I was looking, WHO, World Health Organization, you know, they estimate by the year 2020, there'll be something like 76 million people blind in the earth. And many of them could receive sight if people would go. So should we? Should we? Should we help? Because we need to confront our fears. We need to confront the challenges that we are faced with. But together, we can actually do an incredible amount. I'd like to introduce Brett Curtis. He's a good friend. And he's actually one of the presidents or directors of one of the ships that we operate. So, Brett.
Thank you, Ken. Hello, family. If we're to go to the uttermost parts of the world, we have to reach the isolated islands. Do you agree? We must reach them. That's why YWAM uses ships. In the last decade, as we've done this, we've seen the favor of God poured out on this. And today, I'm so happy to report, now we have 24 vessels spread around the world, bringing God's love to the isolated. Yes, you can give God a clap for that. It's incredible. It's from Eastern Europe into the Mediterranean. There's 9 up the Amazon River. They're in Colombia. They're in Panama. We're in Mexico. We're up on as far as up as Alaska, all the way down to New Zealand, going up into Vanuatu and to Fiji and to Papua New Guinea. And the list is growing. We just had a ship equip ministry conference, and our brothers from Singapore, oh, I forgot to mention, Singapore's in the game too. But others are coming and saying, we have to reach those who are difficult to access. As we look at Pacifica in particular, there's 1,100 island groupings in the big liquid continent. 900 of them have no airport. There's no way to get there yet but by a ship. In the Line Islands in Micronesia, there's three islands down there, and you have to sail 10 days from the nearest island just to get there. The only way then we can get our students in their field assignments to reach these places is by ship. The only way we get to be Jesus to them and reach them where they have a felt need is to climb up the gangway and go on a ship, to distribute Bibles, to take the Jesus film, to minister to their needs. These vessels are floating communities of hope. When you have a ship, you can't kind of sneak in the back door. You've got to come in through the front door. And you've got to come by invitation. PNG is the largest nation in Pacifica with nearly 8 million people, yet they only have one dentist to 100,000 people. Now, I don't know about you, but when I have a toothache, my day stops and I need the dentist. Do you agree? Some of these guys never see a dentist in their lifetime. There's only 9 eye surgeons in the entire nation. Worse still, there's only 5 orthopedic surgeons in that entire nation. They have 291 remote islands. So in places like this, ships aren't just a good idea. They're the only option. Since January on board the Pacific Link, just 50 crew, we've delivered 4,600 Bibles, seen 3,100 people come to Christ because of acts of compassion and mercy when people didn't expect it. Yeah, you can give thanks for that. Thank you, Jesus. See, when you live in a remote village, the only thing that carries hope comes across the horizon. The islands await. The islanders await. Right now, there's a real strategic season in Papua New Guinea. Doors of invitation have opened wide. The trust, the favor, the invitation from the highest offices of the land, as you saw. With 3 vessels committed there now, but we could do with 10. Easy. Your YWAM location can do this. Your businesses can engage this. Teams can walk up the gangway and live for a couple of weeks as we go to remote island after remote island. See, in 33 years, Karen and I have never seen before a host government pay for fuel. Local corporates pay for dock and for pilots and for longshoremen. Last week, we signed up a 5-year agreement with one island in the nation that wanted us to repeat visit. Please, come back, come back, come back. They, wherever we go, they beg us to return. The nation is requesting long-term involvement from the twins. The twins, the ships, and the university working collaboratively together. See, this is a two-hand approach. Vessels establish a quick, deep trust, and then the university, with its 100-year strategy, brings life-changing education to a nation decade after decade at their invitation. They want to be known as a Christian nation, and they're asking for our help. Can we do this? Yes, we can.
My name is Robert Puyu, and I'm from Papua New Guinea, but my wife and I live in Bangladesh, beautiful nation of Bangladesh, for the last 21 years. As a Papua New Guinean, I want to welcome you to Papua New Guinea and also to the Pacific Islands. My wife is from Samoa, so I have the right to welcome you to the Pacific Islands. I'm so blessed, like Victor in the Bible, well, not in the Bible, but in the video that we've seen, that Victor said he loved Papua New Guinea. And I do love Papua New Guinea as well. It has been my home, a place that I grew up. And as I look at this story and the videos being played, I think of my journey just before civilization in the 50s. And in the 50s, civilization came in, and about 30 years later, I got a call. A man in white appeared to me, and he said, Robert, I have chosen you to be a missionary. And he showed me where I will go, the country that I will go. And that's only after 30 years later. I went to different places, different persons to ask me or encourage me to be a missionary. And everyone said, you cannot be a missionary. And during that time, a team, the first YWAM team, came from Hong Kong, a team called Feed Team. And they were a group of young people, the first team ever come to my village and said, you can be a missionary. And it's amazing what God does and what your influence can be, because God already is there doing things in those nations. In the nation of Papua New Guinea, God is already there. We ask you to come and be part of what God is doing in that nation. I pray one time that Bible in every home will be in the nation of Bangladesh and Papua New Guinea and transform the whole nation of that nation. I pray at a time as well with your involvement where medical issues would be only a history, and that the difference that we do in Papua New Guinea will make a huge difference in the 50 years to come, 100 years, the fruits will remain and change and transform that nation. And we want to ask you to be participant of what God is doing, participate in what God is doing in the nation of Papua New Guinea and the Pacific Islands. There's a saying in Papua New Guinea, we call it Oro. My friend Winterford usually called Oro in his language. Oro, Oro means welcome to Papua New Guinea. Welcome to our nation of Papua New Guinea. God is doing a great thing in that nation. And I pray that you would come and be partake what God is doing in the nations, and in the nation of Papua New Guinea, but also in the Pacific Islands as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Robert. You can stay here, brother. Wow. Well, this is how you get connected. If you look up on the screen, there'll be a contact coming up there any second now. There we go. So if you grab out your phones right now, this is how you get connected. We invite you to put yourself in the picture. See yourself on one of our ships, doing a DTS, getting a medical, marine, catering, laboratory experiencing, doing your university internship on board a ship. Do a short-term course or a university track with University of the Nations, a degree track with one of the campuses around the world. Do a short-term outreach, 3 weeks. That's all it takes to do a short-term outreach for our own location. We train you. You don't have to be medical. We'll do the inductions. You can be on a community development team. We are in urgent need of medical and galley crew for this year. So we invite you to come. We invite you to come. I'd like to invite to the stage as we close Sue Cole, our Singapore ambassador. We have John Dawson, our international global ambassador. Brett, who you met earlier. Ken Mulligan, you met earlier. David Stevenson, director of the Ruach. We want to issue you a call to come. Come to the Pacific. Come. This is your invitation to join us. There is a place for everyone. John, did you want to say last words?
was living on board one of the ships in the middle of a big first world city a few weeks ago. And I noticed that as people came on board, it was a language they understood. People who were not believers wanted to get involved. People who were from engineering wanted to get involved. People who were involved in government and education and all of the arts, from romantic dreamers to people who were practical technicians. They were pressing us and saying, I want in. So as we go into this week of considering God immersing the nations in his ways, the dignity of all of the vocations, each one being sacred, not just in the church mission sphere, we need across, first of all, you as entrepreneurial missions leaders in our 56th year to respond in a new level to the gift of faith, with the gift of faith to the legacy that's there. We have the young man, Lauren Cunningham, having his dream of the big white ship. We had a kind of a rocky start, but we're in a period of multiplication. So may the Holy Spirit come upon us right now. Here in Kansas City is a threshold of crossing over into a season of multiplication. We have these thousands of training vocations, but we only have 24 vessels. That might sound impressive, but all it is a seed pod that's being scattered. And so now, wherever you are, most of the nations represented in this room have some kind of maritime history or association or geography. And your great port cities have people within them that have these giftings. We can see Ken and Robin that came from an inland place. Robin comes from Peak Hill, which is about as far from the sea as you can get. And yet she's a righteous Deborah engaged in this vision. So may the Lord open the eyes of our understanding in this part of our godly dream. May we receive a new measure of the gift of faith. You can see that this presentation was about two things. One was a tool which has an ambassadorial function and captures people's imagination and allows them to imagine themselves bringing contribution, the ships. The other was a whole nation of nearly 8 million people, the Mount Everest of cultural diversity, 852 languages, that says our only hope of being a nation is if our foundation is an allegiance to Jesus and a biblical worldview. So now we call you from all of the legacies of your story, from ancient Israel, from Armenia that came next, and all of the ethnicities and church histories and redemptive graces of the story and works of Jesus down through these 2,000 years. In Jesus' name, report for duty in this location. For many of you, that will simply be to take a position of watching in prayer, because this is a time in which God has mounted a battle for Polynesia and Melanesia and has global implications. For some of you, we here invite you to follow us out the door. We're going back in a few days, and there is a place for you. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord bless you.
Thank you.
All right.
Live mics, go.
Awesome. How's everyone doing today? All right. Would you guys put your hands together one more time for Ken Mulligan and all that they're doing with YWAM ships? Come on, really. Let's honor God for what he's doing, taking the gospel to the nations and the unreached. Also, would you guys put your hands together for David Hamilton and the Source View Bible and all of those things that are happening right now? I want to encourage you. Seriously, who likes free stuff? Come on, free 99. I love free stuff. I want to encourage you today, be sure to get the Source View Bible. Go to your app store today, get that. It's going to be an incredible tool for you as you study the word. So Eunice, what else do we have for us for the rest of the day?
Well, let me tell you, Jason, we have another session before we break for lunch. We have another session of worship led by Laura Hackett Park. You guys can welcome the team as they're setting up. We're going to be going into another session of worship. And then we have Todd White, who's going to be sharing a word with us this morning. How many of you guys are excited to hear from Todd White? Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if you guys saw, but who follows Todd on Facebook? Did you guys see Todd yesterday at the hotel, moving in the supernatural, literally bringing encounter of God to all the different staff members? Check it out there. But Todd's in the house. It's going to be an incredible morning.
We're so excited to have him just share. He just walks in so much authority and the power of the Spirit, as you guys know. So, just continue to be expectant for what God wants to do in this time together. So if you guys can just stand to your feet, we're going to go into another time of worship. Let's give it up for Laura Hackett Park and the team from the International House of Prayer.
We're honored to be here with you today. Check, check, check. Hey, we're honored to be here with you today. We're almost ready.
In the splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, but trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. And how great, and how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, see how great is our God.
Sing age to age.
And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands. Beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one. The Father, Spirit, Son, the Light and the Lamb, the Light and the Lamb. And how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all will see. And my heart.
up to sing out your praise. Taken my shame, drawn me with love and kindness, washed whiter than snow. You have redeemed and made me whole. You have won me, and Jesus, you have won me. You have broken every chain. Took all my guilt and sin. One more time, sing it again. You show me love. Oh, love, you show me love by leaving your throne, by bleeding and dying on your cross, that wonderful cross that took all my. Chain with love.
We are your beloved ones. Oh, we are your family, God.
This life, this love was always meant to be a wild, crazy adventure, discovering the thrill, the rush. The more of you I see, the more it leaves me wanting your everything. I'm running to your name. I've got a flickering flame, but I'm coming anyway. Come and breathe on us. Though my enemy comes, tries to quench it with blood, I'm running to your own. Sing, I've got a flickering flame, but I'm coming anyway. Come and breathe. Power for the weak ones.
is power. There is healing. There is liberty. There is new life. Lord, pour out your spirit on a dry and weary land. We just have burning embers before you. Breathe on us, God. This is a realm of your glory. This is a realm of your grace. And I can feel your mighty power, and it's moving in this place. Oh, the weak ones. Power for the weak ones. We're in the presence of the angels with God's glory on their wings. Like the voice of many waters, I can hear the angels sing, singing. To believe. Oh God, some of us need it today.
We need healing. We need fire. We need restoration for our marriages, for our families. Joining the great cloud of witnesses, standing before our God, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Rapha, He is healer. Every eye, every heart, focused on you now. Jehovah Rapha. Jehovah Rapha. God arrives. Holy, holy, let God arise. Holy, 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 sing it, holy.
Straight a highway, a path for the Lord.
for Jesus is coming soon. We'll call back the sinner, wake up the saints, and let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Come to the wedding like a bride. Church ready for you, every heart longing for a king. We sing, even so, come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, come.
There will be justice.
Will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for a groom. Will be a church ready for you, every heart longing. So come, Lord Jesus, come.
So we wait.
So we wait. We wait for.
We're watching and waiting, God.
But we wait. You're coming soon. So we wait. We wait. God, we wait, you're coming soon.
Like a bride,
like a bride waiting for her groom. We'll be a church ready for you, every heart longing for our King.
And oil is stored, hearts are burning, bridegroom Lord, we will watch, we will pray, we will wait for that day. Lamps are lit, and oil is stored, hearts are burning, bridegroom Lord,
and we are your church,
we are the church. Love makes us strong to lay down our lives.
We take our place.
Yes, we are the church. We are the bride. And love makes us strong. Oh, to lay down our lives.
So come bind us together in love. Bind us together in love. Come bind us together in love while we wait. Bind us together in love. And come bind us together,
bind us together
in love
while we wait.
Bind us together in love.
Take our place, God. Love makes us strong to lay down our life. One more time. We are the church. We are your bride. Love makes us strong to lay down our life. Here we are, God. We take our place. We put down the pointing of the finger against one another. God, bind us together in love. Make us your family. Lord, willing to die the daily deaths and live abundantly in Christ. Lord, to bring many sons and daughters into your family. God, we ask for healing together. Lord, make us strong. Let love make us strong, Lord, that we would lay down our lives for you. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Father, I thank you so much that you would just make us normal. That you would make us normal, a people that are set apart. Set apart, God. Set apart to do good works, and that people would see your people do good works and glorify our Father. Father, I thank you that our good works would come from an amazing, intimate relationship with you, because you're just awesome. God, I thank you. I thank you, Father. Jesus, let it just be about you. Let it not be about ministry. Let it not just be about mission. Let it be about Jesus. Let it be about being commissioned to the primary mission. God, I thank you. Oh, I'm overwhelmed. He's so good. He loves us so much. If we would just know that we know that we know that we know how much he loves us. That's really what it's about. It's about his love for us. God, you are living. You are the living God. Your word is alive. It's sharp. It's active. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, living and powerful, able to divide and separate my soul from my spirit. God, you separate my mind, my will, and my emotions from my spirit, man. Your word divides and separates. God, thank you. Your word goes cellular, goes inside, and transforms every cell of my being, every part of my being. God, I thank you that we are to be so in love with Jesus, the person of Jesus, the man Jesus. God, I thank you that it's not just about me getting out of here. I thank you that it's not just about you coming and rescuing me out of here. I thank you that you set me free from me. The gospel sets you free from you. The living word sets you free from you, so that you can be free from others, so that you can be free to finally be who God's created you to be. Whether you've been a Christian for 40 years or one day, it's the same exact relationship, the same exact intimacy, the same power of God unto salvation. God, I thank you in the name of Jesus that righteousness would prevail once again in your church, God. That we would seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then everything would be added to us. We would never seek stuff, we'd seek you. We'd understand what it means to seek kingdom, because the kingdom of God's not meat or drink, but it's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. The kingdom is in the Holy Spirit. Seeking first what it means to have relationship, to commune with the Holy Spirit. God, the Holy Spirit. Father, there's no other religion on the planet where a king has died to come and make his home inside of his people. God, I thank you for radical grace, the radical forgiveness, the radical mercy. I thank you for real grace, which empowers real truth to happen. I thank you for radical grace, God. Radical grace that enables us to walk like Jesus, because Jesus, you never tried to sin and get away with it. Grace is not a license to sin. Grace is the ability to be holy as he is holy. God, I thank you, your goodness and your mercy. God, we love you and we give you glory. I thank you for another opportunity to just be able to represent you. Because, gosh, I don't know anything else. I love you with all my heart. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. God, let us keep it simple. Father, I thank you so much in the name of Jesus, God. Help me help people. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Wow. Okay, so I'm going to pour my heart out for a few minutes. And I've already wasted a couple, but not really. Because if I just seek him with everything that I do, he's alive, he's living. It says in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, which means that when I look into the Bible, when I look into that Word, it's actually looking at God himself. It's looking into the face of God, and no one can look into the face of God and live. Listen, I was a guy that never read a book before. I couldn't read. So when the Bible was introduced into my life, I came out of 22 years of addiction and atheism and hatred and anger, and I never could read because my brain couldn't comprehend. I'd forget everything. So when I started to read this, it was like, it didn't make any sense to me. But no books did. But this Bible's not meant for your brain, it's meant for your heart, because your heart can take you places your brain can't fit. I have to fix this because this is messed up. It's true. I don't just get into the Word to try to memorize the Bible. I get into it to actually commune with my Father. See, God doesn't just want us to memorize the Word. He wants us to become the very Word that we're reading. You are to be a living epistle known and read by all men. Everywhere you go, people should want to have a relationship with Jesus because you're walking out the Word. You're not walking out religion. Religion hurts people. Unless it's religion that they describe in the Bible, which is caring for widows and orphans and keeping yourselves unspotted by the world. That's lovely. But keeping yourself unspotted by the world doesn't just come because I've read a bunch of what's in here. It's because I've actively become what's in here. Are you with me? I don't have any spectacular message. When I said that, God, you would make people normal, I meant what I said. To me, normal is not just studying this Word so that I can come up in front of you and impress you. That's not normal. That's abnormal. That's putting on a show. It's not about a show. You know, yesterday I get on a plane and I'm sitting. There's a huge convention in town. It's a denomination that's doing some huge convention. And I sit down on the plane beside this man, and he's dressed up in a nice suit and tie, and he looks amazing. And I'm not against looking amazing. I wear suits. I do. I just
I'm talking to him. I sit down, and he looks at me. I have a guitar on my back, and he goes, "Hey, man." He goes, "I like music." He goes, "Music's what makes the world go round." And I said, "No." I said, "Music doesn't make the world go round." I said, "Jesus makes the world go round." And he said, "Okay." And he just looked at me. Now, he's a pastor. He's a pastor of a certain denomination. Because I'm not trying to drag a denomination through the mud, because Jesus didn't say, go make a bunch. He just said, worship me. Worship my Father. He paid a price for us to have a relationship with the Father. So I'm sharing with him that instrument that I have, I play worship. He goes, "Well, I actually preach the word." And I said, "Yes, sir." I said, "That's awesome." And I said, I just bring my guitar so that in my bedroom, I can actually have communion with God and worship God through the Holy Spirit. But when I mentioned the Holy Spirit, it got weird. But it shouldn't be weird. I mean, you can't worship Jesus without the Holy Spirit anyway. So it shouldn't be weird when I talk about the Holy Spirit. See, some people, look, we can't afford to, as the church, as a spirit-filled church, we can't afford to be so heavenly minded that we're earthly flaky. We can't afford to be so focused on heaven and so in worship that we can't be productive. I mean, we need to do our jobs as unto the Lord and not for people, but we need to be possessed by the Holy Spirit. We need to be possessed by the living Word, possessed with Him. And we need to flow with Him and function with Him and have relationship with Him. Jesus walked, and everybody desired Him. In Him was the light of men. The light of men was in Jesus Christ. In Jesus. And then Jesus tells us in the Gospels that we are the light of the world. Jesus says, "I'm the light of the world." And then He says, "Now you're the light of the world." It's in the Beatitudes. It's amazing. It's the attitudes of being. It's my be attitudes. It's who I am because of what He did. Because if I see what He did to make me who I am, I'll never try to do to be. I will just be to do. And all of a sudden, it's my be attitude. It's amazing. It's the most amazing section of Scripture. My daughters, they say, "Dad, you say that about everything." But when I'm in it, that's the most amazing section of Scripture. It is. It's Matthew 5-7. It's like they're all red letters. How can you get out of it? It's amazing. But the first part of that is this, and this is where you can really, really go south. It says, "Blessed are those that are poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God." See, if you're full in spirit, then you don't think you need the kingdom of God. It's crazy, because what spirit are you full of? It could be the pride of life. It could be to receive honor and glory from people. But to be poor in spirit means that I have to have the fear of the Lord, which is the beginning of wisdom. But I also am teachable, because poor in spirit means that I am not spiritually arrogant, and I am teachable, and I want to be taught by my Father. The Holy Spirit, the kingdom of God, is not meat or drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So blessed are those that are poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom. So blessed are those that are not spiritually arrogant, for theirs is the Holy Ghost. I love this, because it's about intimacy. This book is alive, but it's not meant for your brain. But you can be spiritually arrogant and puffed up, and you can move in all kinds of gifting even, and power, and you can heal the sick and cleanse the lepers and raise the dead and all that amazing stuff that God says to do. But then He says in Matthew 7, He says, you know, not everybody that says to me, "Lord, Lord," will enter in. So I'm talking about religion, but I'm also talking about spiritual flakiness. This is a huge deal. See, normal isn't going and healing the sick and thinking that your identity comes because someone got healed. The disciples healed the sick and weren't even saved. The disciples were not even born again. What they did was they healed the sick as orphans and thought, "Who's the greatest?" They had no idea who they were. They walked with Jesus. "Who do you say I am?" Who do people say I am? Well, some say this and some say that. And, well, some people say a lot of things. Yeah, but who do you say I am? "Well, you're the Christ," Peter says. "You're the Son of God." Jesus, "Wow. Blessed are you, Simon. You didn't come up with that one yourself." The Father told you that. As a matter of fact, it's amazing. Upon this rock, I'm going to build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And I tell you that in that day, I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Way to go, Simon. Woo! Awesome. You know, Simon's like, yeah! Did you hear what he said about me? Me. Look what I did. Look what I said. Look what I came up with. No, Jesus told you didn't come up with that. Yes, yes, I did. That's spiritual arrogance. Blessed are those that are poor in spirit. That's not poor in spirit. That's full of self. Look what I did. Jesus, by the way, they're going to kill me. What? I don't think so. Not on my watch, bro. Simon. Get behind me, Satan. That's crazy. Wait, whoa, 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 easy, dude. Hey, king. You just told me I heard from God. Now, you can't just call me the devil. Are you with me? These are guys that walk with the king. Get behind me, Satan. He says, for your mind is full of the things of men and not the things of God. What did he say? He said, the next time you want to use the excuse, hey, chill out, I'm only human, you're saying, hey, back off, I'm only demonic. I'm really not, that's really serious. Serious, because we incorporate the way that seems right to a man into the gospel, and the way that seems right to a man leads to destruction, and it'll kill us. Submission and surrender couldn't be given to Peter until the Holy Ghost was poured out. See, we have the kingdom. See, Jesus paid a price on the day of Pentecost that transformed this man that denied Jesus into a lover of God. Into one that was so bold that instead of after that he denied Jesus, instead of denying Jesus, he stood before the Sanhedrin because of the guy at the gate beautiful. Gets up, he stood before the Sanhedrin. They said, you will no longer speak in this man's name. And instead of denying him, Peter said, nope, already went there, dude. Not happening again. Why? Because he was possessed by the spirit of truth. This is so powerful, so amazing. He's not living to please people anymore. See, if I want to please you, then I'm going to tell you what you want to hear. I will be an entertainment. I will be entertaining for you. I love to have people laugh, but see, the Holy Spirit is, it's like aphrodisia. It's like anesthesia. People go, oh, and then he goes, and he brings that up and makes it mind renewal. I love God with all my heart, but let's keep the main thing the main thing. The one thing that's necessary is that we be the feet of Jesus. It wouldn't be about just being at a meeting. See, for me, I live before an audience of one every second of every day. To me, whether I'm on a plane with people that can't stand me, it doesn't matter. Because the reality of them not standing me doesn't mean that I'm not going to stand them. I love them. So regardless of how they treat me, I'm going to treat him different. See, the gospel demands change. See, grace, any grace that doesn't lead to transformation is demonic in nature. It's really powerful. Grace demands change. People say, well, God likes me just the way I am. He does, but he doesn't expect you to stay that way. He saves you. And if you get saved, what do you get saved from and what do you get saved to? You get saved to a kingdom, to something that's not even of this world, so that now you become a person that's possessed by the kingdom of God, by the Holy Spirit. You start to learn the things that aren't okay with God because you study the things that are okay with God. You study the real and the counterfeits exposed. Then all of a sudden, you start to be in union with God and you start to hear his voice everywhere you go. The first voice that I heard when I got saved is that I was forgiven. Crazy, ridiculous, because 22 years of addiction and atheism and anger and hatred and all that junk. I had issues, man. My life was, it was just nothing but issues. But when I came to Jesus, the living word, Jesus, the living word, he canceled my lifetime subscription to issues. He really did. And now I just get to be possessed by love itself. God is love. That's what it says. You read 1 John 4, right? It's all over the word. But God is love, and Jesus came to reveal God. He came to reveal the Father. Are you with me? Okay, let's see. Colossians 1:15 says that Jesus was the visible image of the invisible God. That means that visibly, he represented what God was invisibly. When you see Jesus, you saw what visibly, what God looked like, right? Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3 says that Jesus was the express image of the Father. The express image, the exact, exactly what God was, Jesus was. John 14, he's with the disciples. He's about to be taken away. And he's with the disciples, and he's talking about being the way, the truth, and the life. I'm glad he didn't say, no one comes to heaven except by me. If he'd have said that, then it would be about me praying a prayer to get out of here, praying for Jesus to rescue me. But when you find out that he didn't say that, he said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. That changes things. Then I no longer look at the rapture as a rescue mission. I look at it as a pickup for a wedding date. This is amazing. Therefore, I'm not praying for him to rescue me. Yes, I want him to come back. Yes, but I have so many people that I know in my life that aren't ready. And I don't want them to see hell. I want them to see heaven. So God, have mercy. Here's my prayer. God, make me a better witness today. Jesus, I want to be a better witness. I want to be a better witness. God, help me to hear your voice clear. Father, I thank you. I study your word, not to preach myself approved, but to show myself approved. That everywhere I go, I'm actually the demonstration of what the truth of your word says. I'm going to rightly divide the word of truth. Rightly divide. Not read it for selfish gain. Not read it to preach to somebody. Read it and say, God, your word is a light. It's a lamp unto my feet. I read it so you can cut me deep and reveal anything that needs to change. My God, mold me and shape me. You are the master potter. I am the clay. Show me who you've created me to be so I can burn like fire and the world around me can be set ablaze. That's it. God, don't let me walk into a place and not everybody know. Let everybody know that I represent you. Don't let me sit on an airplane unless everybody knows that I'm on there and that you live in me. It's not about anything else. God, let me, when I walk by a janitor, let me love that janitor and bring Christ to them. Let me never think that people are an inconvenience because I'm headed to A to B. Traffic. Oh, I can't stand traffic. But what do you do in traffic? Do you shut your windows, bang on the car wheel and say, man, I can't believe this? Or do you realize that there are people that are dying and going to hell all around you and that your life is the living word? I'm just saying. Are you with me? This is all I know and it's all I've known. I've been saved. I've been set free from me for 12 years this year. 12 years. I was a drug addict and an atheist for 22 years. And for 34 years, not one Christian came up to me and told me that Jesus loved me here in America. Not one. Sometimes we boil this thing down and say, well, you know, that's just for evangelists. You're wrong. It's for believers that believe. But what do you believe? What do you believe? This is not just for evangelists. Man, the fivefold gift, pastors, apostles, prophets, evangelists, teachers, the fivefold is to equip the sinners for the work of ministry. No, it's not. That's not scripture. The Bible says it's for the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry. Sometimes, a lot of times, we haven't realized who God says we are when we get saved. When we get saved, we move from being sinners that get saved by grace through faith to being put into the kingdom of his marvelous light. We move from darkness into light. Ephesians 5 says, therefore, be imitators of God, dear children, and walk in love. Come on, this is the Bible. It says you were darkness. It says, it doesn't say you're a little darkness, and the Bible doesn't say, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. It sounds catchy, but it's not true. You're not a little light. You're not a little light. See, when I walk into a dark place, it gets brighter because I shine. I am the light of the world. You are the light of the world. What would it be like for all of us to know that? What would it be like for all of us to know and to be secure in our identity and know that we are the light of the world? A city on a hill, a light that lights up your own house. It's powerful. That means that if I walk into a dark place, it gets light because I'm there. Doesn't matter how dark it is. What matters is that light showed up. It's amazing. What a privilege. What an opportunity. Sometimes people are like, man, I just need to get into ministry, man, because my job, and man, my boss is mean. They're mean, and it's dark, and I just need maybe get a Christian job. And that's wrong. That's not what Jesus said. Jesus said, now all of you huddle together and get Christian jobs and separate yourself from the world to come out from it and don't get close to it. Because if you do, you're going to get dirty and slimed. No. He says, be the light of the world, because when you show up, I show up. And when I show up, light shows up. In John 14, he says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. And the disciples get it weirded out, and they say, okay, then show us the Father. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. Truth, life, Father. Okay, show us the Father. It'll be sufficient. Jesus says, have I been with you so long, and you don't know me? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Don't you realize that the Father is in me and I'm in the Father? If you don't believe that, then if you don't believe the things that I say, at least believe the things that I do, because it's the Father that dwells in me that does the works. So how can you say that? Well, as a matter of fact, he who believes in me, the same things that I do, he's going to do, because I'm going to go and be with the Father. And they're like, no, don't leave us. No, guys, it's going to be better for you that I go away. Because if I don't go, he won't come. It's going to be better. My presence with you, you hanging out, you seeing the loaves multiply, the fish multiplied, the people healed, all these multitudes healed. It's amazing. And I've given you exousia authority. But when I go, dunamis is coming. And when he comes, wow, it's going to be awesome. Because I'm going to pray for you. He says in John 17, I don't pray for those that are here, but I pray for all of those who believe in me through their word. He says that I am in you and you're in me, and that we may be in them, that the world might know that you sent me. And the same glory that you've given me, I've given to them. Oh, this is amazing. I'm like, oh God, really? Well, my biggest, most amazing heart cry for the church, for the body of Christ, is the reality of what it means to be right with God. I've lived my life. I've lived for 12 years in the gospel, and I've not had one day of guilt or shame or condemnation. I'm not some super Christian. I'm a son. See, I'm not an orphan. Jesus says, don't worry, guys, I'm going away, but I will not leave you as orphans. And I see so many people that are trying to one-up each other or trying to maneuver for this or for that. I didn't try to get into ministry, man. I just love Jesus full time. Like, I realized that when I got saved, I got born again. I got refathered. I got a brand new dad. So no matter what my original dad did or didn't do, I had a heavenly Father that did. Like, all generational curses, all that stuff, I didn't have any Christians in my family. When I got saved, like, I had some real heathen on the way down the line. Like, really. And then that generational curse thing, it continues to a third and fourth generation. But you know what happens when one person when righteousness comes upon that person, the reality of that leads its legacy to 1,000 generations. I mean, what kind of generational curse can make it through a changed bloodline? The blood of Jesus has set me free. It's Jesus. It's the name of Jesus. It's the name above all names. It's the name that's worthy to be praised. It's the ones that devils, the one that devils fear, that the world fears it. I mean, you can be talking to people and it's all good. Say the name of Jesus and see what happens. Oh, yeah, man, God, he's awesome. Yeah, I believe in God. How about Jesus? Why? Because that draws the line. Because there's many gods, little g. But there's only one Jesus. There's only one Jesus. We can't afford to not know him. And we can't afford to not know that we've been righteously. Like Jesus, the one who knew no sin. He became sin, so I might become something. But if I don't understand what I've become, I might continue to do in order to be right with God. You can't do enough to be right with God. Jesus did what he did so that you could become the righteousness of God. That means that God gave you his righteousness. There's no way to earn it. There's no way. You have to become it. And the only way to become it is to believe that what Jesus did is enough for you to be who God says you are. There's no other way to do this thing. See, for me, I had so many sin. I mean, I'm talking like 22 years of addiction, atheism, grew up, was raised by the Masonic homes, by the Freemasons. Like, my whole life was riddled with trash. And when I got saved, it wasn't because like super witnesses came to me, hey man, you better repent, hey, God loves you, hey, God has a plan for your life, hey, you know you're just going to be speaking on a stage in front of thousands of people in a couple years. No, because dude, I was in prison, I was in jail, I was extradited across America, I was kicked out of the Marines, I hurt people, manipulated people, maneuvered people, I was that guy at the gatherings who had issues upon issues upon issues, but Jesus said, that's not who you've been created to be. But it took me getting shot at in a drug deal to realize that he loved me. That's ridiculous. Shot at from 10 feet away. And I hear a voice say, I took those bullets for you. Are you ready to live for me yet? Ridiculous. No. Like that's just the end of this trauma life. Jesus speaks to me. It tells me that. I've been with my girlfriend for 9 years. I destroyed her life. Had a daughter that was 7.5 years old. I told my girlfriend if she ever left me, I would kill her, kill whoever she's with, and kill myself. And my daughter grew up that way for 7.5 years. And so at this point, 5.5 months earlier, I had somebody talk to me about Jesus because I went to the church suicidal. I was going to blow my brains out. And this guy told me, since I don't want my life, why don't I give it to somebody that does? And I thought to myself, who would want my life because all I've done is hurt people? He said, Jesus. I said, come on, dude. How could some dead guy 2,000 years ago? This is so dumb. And he said, that's just it. He's alive. And here's what I didn't understand, all the things that he was saying, but I saw something in his eyes that was real. And the Bible says that the eye is the lamp of the body. And if your eye is single, your whole body is full of light. But the light that is in you is darkness. How great is that darkness? But when I looked into this man's eyes, which I couldn't really stare into because something was in there, he shared with me and he said, since you don't want your life, why don't you just give it to him? I went, dude, whatever. He can have my life, okay? That was my prayer. Now watch. So he said, all right, here's my number. You're going to need it. I said, why would I need your number, man? He goes, just take it. I go, okay, whatever. I left. I went home. I called my girlfriend's moms because I knew that's where they were because my daughter left a note. And I said, you need to tell mommy, because my daughter answered the phone. You need to tell mommy that daddy found God. My daughter said, what's he like? I said, I don't know. But I met somebody today that claims to, and there's something about this guy's eyes. You got to see it. My little daughter, 7.5, she goes, daddy, mommy's never coming home. I said, honey, you tell mommy she's got to come home because you love your daddy. So you kick and scream. And she did. And mom came home. I can't believe this, you lying hypocrite. I said, no way. I would never be a hypocrite. She said, whatever. You're sleeping on the couch. I hate you. And that's just our life. That's how we live. She was an atheist. So I slept on the couch. I put my daughter to bed that day. And I told her, daddy's going to change. Everything's going to change. She goes, daddy, I'm so glad that you found God. It should be a hallelujah. But I put my daughter to bed, and in an hour and a half, I'm out on a cocaine binge. Because what I had was a confession, but no relationship. I didn't realize the relationship. So for 5.5 months, 3 or 4 times a week, I'm out on binges, lost. 5.5 months later, I pick up some kid and rip him off for a bunch of cocaine. I tell him that I'm a cop, and he gets out of the car. He's screaming at me, and the door shuts, and I hit the gas, and he unloaded a 9mm at me. And a voice said, I took those bullets for you. Are you ready to live for me yet? And I had no idea what it was. I thought I got shot. And I went home that night after I did all the cocaine and couldn't get high because that voice killed my buzz. I got home in the morning, and there wasn't one bullet hole in my car. And that right there was the most freakiest time of my life. I went to the door. She said, get out. I left. I went to a place called Teen Challenge. I went to Teen Challenge for 2 months. And I had a radical encounter with Jesus. The Bible opened up to me. The first scripture that opened up is, if you lack wisdom, ask God. And I had 3 encounters, 3 nights in a row with the person of Jesus, and he told me to go home. And when I went home, I had to tell my daughter how sorry I was because I realized I was a dad for the first time in my life. And I held my daughter, and I had to tell her I couldn't live there. And she said, don't, Daddy, this is your home. I said, no, you don't understand. But then mommy came out of the house, and when she did, I told her I was sorry. And she said when I went away, Jesus, she'd given her life to Jesus. And we got married 4 days later in between first and second service at church. And that was 12 years ago. Could you guys stand to your feet? Could you do me this big favor? I want you to yell Jesus as loud as you can on the count of three. Wait, hold on. On the count of three. One. 2, 3. Jesus! One more time on the count of three. 1, 2, 3. Jesus! One more time. 1, 2, 3.
Come on, put your hands together for Jesus today. Come on, make some noise. Would you guys do me one more favor? Would you guys just put your hands together for Todd White one more time? We honor you, Todd White. Thank you for inspiring a generation to show us what's possible in God. I want to encourage all of you. Todd White is still going to be with us the rest of the day. Tonight, you do not want to miss tonight's session. We have Todd White, and we also have Rick Pino in the house. Do y'all know who Rick Pino is? That should be illegal tonight. You want to be here, get a seat. It's going to be wild. But you want to be here tonight. It's going to be incredible. But before you guys break for lunch, Eunice, would you tell us what to expect?
So in the afternoon, we are going to have the founder of YWAM, Lauren Cunningham, starting exactly at 2 o'clock. So please be on time. We're going to start exactly at 2. So go and grab a quick bite to eat for lunch and come back early. Grab your seats. One thing that we want to remind you guys is that we actually will not allow anyone to save seats. So please grab all your belongings. Don't leave anything on your chairs. If you leave anything, we will remove them. So come early, grab a bite to eat, come early, and be expectant for the founder of YWAM to speak in the afternoon, 2 o'clock. Again, if you guys are looking for restaurants to eat, there's gonna be food trucks right outside that are gonna be available for you. And then there will be information packets on the way out from the ushers. It will have all the restaurants that are walking distance from this area for you guys to go walk, grab a bite to eat, get some coffee, and we'll see you back here at 2 o'clock.
All right, 2 p.m., we'll see you guys. Lauren Cunningham and Jay Thomas, do not miss it. Be here on time. We'll see you guys later.